I am on 6th Avenue in New York, also called Avenue of the Americas, in honor of Latin American nations. It ends here at Central Park, where we have statues for Latin American liberators. We have a statue of José Martí, the liberator of Cuba, a statue of Simón Bolívar, who led the independence of Venezuela, Colombia, Ecuador, Bolivia, and Panama. And finally, José de San Martín, who led the independence movement of Argentina, Chile, and Peru. They were all influenced by the American Revolution. In a sense, it's ironic. Like all leaders, the 18th century King of Spain, Carlos III, made decisions based on his country's interests. Spain entered the American Revolution based on their rivalry with the British, their alliance with the French, and their territorial interest. While Spain was integral in the Americans' victory in the war, Spain also won back Florida, the island of Menorca, and reduced the British presence in Central America. Still, wars have unintended consequences. In this case, the American Revolution would become a turning point in Latin America. This wasn't unforeseen. The Spanish were hesitant to enter the American Revolution because they feared that a republic in North America would be an example for their colonies. At the same time of the American Revolution, the largest indigenous rebellions in South America took place, led by Tupac Amaru in Cusco and Tupac Katari in La Paz. In fact, the Spanish were so concerned of rebellion that they prohibited the circulation of the American Declaration of Independence throughout their colonies. Still, it was impossible to keep all of Latin America in the dark. In 1809, El Primer Grito, the Manifesto of the People of Quito, was signed. It was based in part on the American Declaration of Independence. Soon after, Colombia, Venezuela, and Mexico would sign their own declarations of independence.
It's definitely correct to think of the US as an example. And maybe example is a better word than model. Because I think there were lots of debates about what the best model to follow was and what was the best structure of government. And some people were saying we should structure our government exactly like the United States. Other people were saying we need a combination of what's going on in the US and something like a parliamentary monarchy in Great Britain. Other people were more enamored of the French Revolution. But what American independence or US independence meant for Latin America was that the idea of having a self-governing republic that used to be a colony was a workable idea. That was very important.
Other Latin Americans had firsthand experience with the American Revolution.
Francisco de Miranda was a Venezuelan who fought in the American Revolution under Bernardo de Galvez, helping to capture the Bahamas. But he was very badly treated by Galvez and the Spanish crown, which turned him against the Spanish Empire and turned him into a Venezuelan nationalist. He learned a lot from George Washington and Thomas Jefferson about how to conduct a revolution. He led the Venezuelan fight for independence against Spain, which failed, but it paved the way for Simón Bolívar and José de San Martín, who succeeded.
In 1811, Miranda established the first Republic of Venezuela. It was short-lived, but its legacy lives on till today. Miranda designed a flag for his republic. The red, yellow, and blue flag is still found in the flags of Venezuela, Colombia, and Ecuador today. His disciples, Simón Bolívar and José de San Martín, lived to see out Miranda's dream of free republics in South America. At the same time, the United States, no longer part of the British Empire, increased its ties with Latin America. Latin American elites also made New York their home. In fact, it was on this corner of Nassau and Fulton in New York in 1850 that the first Cuban flag was flown. The flag, sewn by hand in the New York boarding house, would become the Cuban national flag used today. It was in this New York, a New York of Hispanic thinkers, a fast-growing, cutting-edge city, that the Cuban lawyer José Martí arrived.
José Martí, regarded as one of the architects of Cuban independence, spent very important years as a writer in New York City, writing newspaper articles about New York City. Some of his famous titles include Our America, by which he makes a contrast between North America and Latin America, and the truth about the United States, la verdad sobre los Estados Unidos. For Martí, being in the US was a way to think of the United States as something other than an economic monolith or a sort of single register symbol for power or for a single idea. He's very interested in the plurality of the United States, the tensions, racial, class-based, that are present in New York City when he's there are really important in his work. He's really interested in getting his readers to think about the U.S. in a critical way, thinking about what is useful as an example from the U.S. and what can be discarded.
He absorbed American culture, and although Martí was critical of the United States and worried of their influence in Latin America, it is clear from his writing that he was as influenced by George Washington, Ralph Waldo Emerson, and Walt Whitman as he was influenced by Francisco de Miranda and Simón Bolívar. In 1895, Martí returned to his native Cuba to join an independence movement. 3 months later, he was tragically shot and killed by a Spanish bullet. This statue on Central Park South captures that moment. Today, there are over 50 million Spanish speakers in the United States. Many of them have arrived in recent decades, but they are part of a continuation of a relationship between the US and the Spanish-speaking world that dates back to the founding of the United States and the founding of Latin American countries. We are one and the same.